passage that actually we just prayed together. We're going to look at the Lord's Prayer. So I guess there's two reasons why I could just say amen and walk off and we can all go home, but I worked hard this week, so we're going to do that. So if you have a Bible with you or a phone or iPad or something with a Bible on it and want to follow along, this is from Matthew 6, starting in verse 5. Matthew 6, verse 5. I'll give you a second to find it if you're looking with me. We'll put it in a little bit of context. I know we just heard these words, but a little bit of context for what Jesus said. Matthew 6 says, "And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, don't keep on babbling like the pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for teaching us how to pray. We ask that you show us more about who you are and who we are as your people as we dig into this prayer that you gave us this morning. Lord, we pray all these things. Amen.
Amen.
So for those of us who have been around Harbor Church for a while, even more than 1 week, we're kind of familiar with the Lord's Prayer around here. We say it every week together, just like we did this morning. And some of you probably have it memorized even. We've done it so often around here, probably in other places in your life. I won't test you, I promise. But sometimes that kind of familiarity with something, though, kind of makes it lose its luster. You know, it kind of helps us become desensitized to what we're saying. And so this morning, I really want to take some time and break down this prayer that Jesus got us and really dig into what Jesus is saying in this prayer that he taught us and hopefully give it some new life in our eyes here at Harbor Church. So first of all, before Jesus even gets to this prayer, he gives it kind of an introduction, doesn't he? He says, okay, here's how I don't want you to pray. And he gives a couple of examples of what not to do when we pray. Jesus says, don't pray loudly and publicly. Don't try and put on a show when you pray like the hypocrites do. Just come to me and pray. Jesus says, it's better to even go somewhere private, close the door, turn off your distractions, get rid of your phone, turn off the TV, and just come to me and pray. You don't have to kind of showboat. We don't have to make a big spectacle of what we're doing and then pray so that people can look at us and see what we're doing. Just come to God and pray. That's the first thing Jesus says not to do. Don't be a showboater when you pray. The second thing Jesus says is don't babble like the pagans who think they'll be heard because of their many words. In other words, don't try and put on airs when you pray. Again, just come and pray. Prayer isn't about putting on a show. Prayer isn't about trying to be someone you're not or trying to find the perfect, most poetic way to ask God for what you're trying to ask, but just to come and pray, to come and relate with God and to share with him your hopes and your dreams and your fears and your wants and your needs. Just come and pray. I know none of you have done this, but I'm sure all of us have heard those people that have kind of a prayer voice, right? I remember the craziest example to me was one time when Jeremy and I went to visit his family in Malaysia. We were at a church, and the pastor at this church he had a very distinctive prayer voice. So those of you who know Jeremy know his accent, and his accent's been kind of tampered since he's been here for over a decade, but there's a Malaysian accent that we heard. And so I was talking to this pastor before the service, and he had a very strong, very thick Malaysian accent. And then as soon as he went to pray, he sounded like he was from Kansas. That was a crazy thing. He really did. And people warned me of this before I went in, and they said, he sounds American. And I went, yeah, okay, maybe to you, but he's not American to me, an actual American. But he had this kind of Southern Baptist drawl going in his prayer. And he was putting on this whole show for prayer. And I think that's a very extreme example, but exactly what Jesus is telling us not to do. Don't try and be someone you're not. Don't try and pray in a way that you heard someone on TV or heard your pastor pray. Just come and pray. Jesus wants us just to come and to talk with him, to be in relationship with him, and share our lives with him, and that's what prayer is all about. So that's how Jesus begins. Don't do these things. Don't pray like this. And then he says, here's how I do want you to pray. And that's when he gives this prayer that we now call the Lord's Prayer as an example of how he does want us to pray. It's a model for us. So this morning, I really want to kind of take this apart with you. I want to really deconstruct this prayer. And Alice, we never connected on this, but she's pointing to the computer. She found my slides. So there are, as I see it, five petitions in the Lord's Prayer, five separate kind of requests or themes in the Lord's Prayer. So I want to take them one by one, and I'll each be on the screen so you don't lose track of where we are. And look at, what is Jesus saying? Why are we being told to say these words when we pray? What does it really mean? And try and get a little bit deeper into this prayer. So here we go. The first petition is, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father who is in heaven, let your name be holy. That's what that means. When Jesus starts his prayer off this way, it's very purposeful. He has a point that he's making in starting off the prayer. You know, often when we pray or when I pray, we start with, Dear God, or if we're teaching a child to pray, it's often, Dear God, thank you for this and this and this and for our food, amen. But Jesus starts with this very kind of poetic, lofty sort of language. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Let your name be holy. And there's a reason for that. In the opening of this prayer, Jesus is drawing out some key components of who God is. And that's where the prayer begins, with this truth about who God is. God is, it says, first of all, our Father. He's relational. He loves us. God moves towards us and wants to be in relationship with us. God is loving and gracious and merciful, like the best possible father you can think of. He's worthy of our childlike awe. I think of how my little one-year-old sees her daddy when he walks in and her smile lights up. And that's how God wants us to see him, as his father. But then the next phrase is, our Father in heaven. Right? So God is our Father. He loves us. He's relational. And also, he's in heaven. He's holy. He's set apart from us. God is God, and we are not. Jesus draws out this kind of mysterious paradox that's in our God, that he's both our Father and he's in heaven. And then Jesus says we want God's name to be hallowed, to be holy, to be revered. This is a statement of worship. It starts off with naming two attributes of God, that he's our Father and that he's in heaven, he's holy, and then he worships him for those truths. He says, holy is your name, praise your name. Jesus ascribes worth to God, ascribes glory and honor and praise. All in this first little phrase in the Lord's Prayer. And that's where Jesus starts. And so Jesus here is teaching us that our prayer begins with worship. Our prayer is more than just coming to God and asking for things we want. Our prayer begins with who God is and us falling down on our knees and worshiping him. That's where prayer begins. Worship. So that's the first petition. We can go to the next one. The second one, second petition is, Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So this is where Jesus gets kind of global and universal in his prayer. This is where Jesus brings in a piece of this huge hope that we have as followers of Christ. Our hope as Christians rests on the knowledge that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. That Christ rules in all things and through all things, and that Christ is coming again one day to set up his rule once and for all, and that every tear will be wiped away and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what that kingdom is about. When Jesus prays, Your kingdom come, your will be done, that's what he has in mind, that this kingdom will fully come to pass, that God will really rule in all people, in all places, in all times, for all eternity. That's what Jesus is praying for. That's a big thing to pray for. We say that every week. We ask for God's kingdom to come. Your kingdom come, set up your rule in our world, in our hearts, and in our lives. Keep your church strong and add to it so that every knee will bow and tongue confess. Rid us of every force that revolts against you, God. That's part of this prayer too. And do this until your kingdom is so complete and perfect that you are finally all in all. Thy kingdom come, those three simple words. That's what's packed into that moment. And furthermore, Jesus says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your will rule in our lives and in our world just as much as it rules in heaven. In other words, let us experience a little piece of heaven, a little piece of eternity right here on earth. Let us be part of that challenge too, to live in such a way that we are showing what that little piece of heaven on earth might look like. Help us live in ways that showcases the hope we have in you. That might be another way to put this petition. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's what Jesus is praying for here. So that's the first two. The third petition is this: give us this day our daily bread. Now here, Jesus kind of brings it back down to kind of a more earthy level, a more everyday level. He just had a big, sweeping, kind of massive statement of thy kingdom come, and now just give us what we need for today. Give us those things that we need for today. It seems so simple, doesn't it? But it's so much easier said than done. I know this for me. What do I need for today? I need so much less than I have. I have so many more things than I need, and I certainly need much less than I want. I don't know about you, but I tend to want a lot more things than I need. I like those little luxuries in life. You know, I like that my iPhone and my iPad sync up with my MacBook, and it's all kind of fun to see it all go together. And I like that this morning I can stand in front of my closet and try on 3 or 4 different outfits before I decided what to wear. And I like that I can stop at Starbucks and grab a $5 latte on my way here. But do I need any of those things? No, I don't think so. Maybe I felt like I needed that coffee this morning, but I really didn't. You know, I like that my family has 2 cars, and I like that we were able to buy a new couch a couple months ago because the problem with our old one was that it was too big. You know, I like that we have the ability to do these things, but I don't need them. And sometimes I think in our convenient and technology-fueled lives, we're convinced that we need a whole lot more than we actually do. If you look at advertising, that's what they're banking on. That you'll get convinced that you need that new iPhone that comes out every single month. And you need this year's new kind of jeans and those kinds of things. Maybe we don't pray that God will give us new jeans. I don't know that any of us are quite that shallow to pray that God will give us new jeans, but I think these kinds of little luxuries seep into our prayer lives in ways that we might not even recognize. I think that the way that we want things and think that we need things that have become normal but are actually pretty luxurious, I think that seeps into our prayer lives, and I think it becomes hard to decipher what exactly it is we need from God. What is it? What is that daily bread that we need for today? I really like how the Heidelberg Catechism, which is one of the confessions of our denomination, the Christian Reformed Church, the Heidelberg Catechism puts it like this: take care of all of our physical needs so that we come to know that you are the only source of everything good, and help us to give up our trust in creatures and put our trust in you alone. Such a simple, beautiful way to put it. It's a trust issue, isn't it? What do we need? God knows, and God promises to give it to us. And that's how Jesus instructs us to pray. So we've gone through 3. Here's number 4. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, a lot of you probably know this isn't about literal debts. This isn't a prayer that God will forgive me my student loans that I racked up through college and seminary. It's not a prayer to forgive our credit card debts or those kinds of things. This is about sin and forgiveness. Forgive us our debts. Forgive us the ways that we've wronged you, Lord. When we sin, when we do things that aren't a part of how God wants us to live, when we do things that hurt ourselves or hurt others, we create a debt with God of sorts. We're not living up to our end of the bargain when we do these things. And that's what Jesus is calling us to pray for forgiveness for. But there's kind of a condition in this statement, isn't there? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive our sins as we forgive those who sin against us, some translations put it. That's a really big statement right there. We're asking God to forgive us in the same way that we forgive others. that puts a lot of importance on what we're doing too. Now, I don't think this goes quite as far to say that if there's someone in your life who's wronged you, or if there's been some tragedy or some big injustice and you haven't forgiven them, I don't think that that means you are not forgiven in a large sense, that you're not saved, that God hasn't forgiven you your sins. I don't think that's what grace is. I think that God forgives us even when we don't know that we're in the bargain. But I do think we're called to have an orientation of forgiveness in our lives and in our faith. Again, the Heidelberg Catechism put it this way: "Forgive us, Lord, just as we are fully determined as evidence of your grace in us to forgive our neighbors. Forgive us as we are fully determined as evidence of your grace in us to forgive others." Because we've received that grace that forgives us even when we're not being very forgiven, even when we have all kinds of debt to God, when we're not holding up our end of the bargain, God forgives us. And because of that grace in us, and through that grace in us, we're called to try and be determined, at least to try to forgive others. That's what this call is. So I don't think it's necessarily a condition that's placed. I don't think that our ultimate forgiveness and our salvation rests in our ability to forgive someone who's wronged us. But I do think that our response to that grace that forgives us should be one of grace towards others, so that we can be determined, as that catechism says, to show grace towards others. It's not an easy thing. That could be a whole sermon in itself. We could be here for hours just looking at that one piece, and maybe it should be. But through God's mercy and strength and grace, that's what he's working in and through us. So forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. That's what Jesus teaches us to pray. And finally, the fifth petition is, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Or sometimes it's the evil one. The Greek there is a little bit funky. But the idea is, Jesus recognizes in his prayer that we face temptation all the time, that the devil and the enemies of Christ and those forces of evil are attacking us constantly. And we're always kind of fighting that battle within ourselves. And we falter in the face of that. We're so often tempted to not live in the ways that those other four petitions request of us to live. We're so often tempted not to seek out God's will on earth, but to seek our own will. And we're tempted not to focus on what we need for the day, but to focus on all those things we want and feel like we need to have, but don't really need. We want to avoid living in the face of grace and forgiveness, because sometimes it's nice to hold on to those grudges. But God has forgiven us, and so he wants us to forgive others. So Jesus tells us to pray, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Don't let us go there, but deliver us instead. And from the evil one, the one who tempts us in the first place. Because it's so difficult to live based on those first four petitions. That's why Jesus adds this fifth one. Because he knows that it's hard to live. Even when we're praying these things faithfully and we're asking for God's help, it's so hard to live based on those four petitions that came before. So he gives us this one as a moment of confession and begging for assurance. And I think that we can trust God to hold up his end of the bargain, that as we pray these things, that he will deliver us from temptation as best he can, and rest in the hope that he's already delivered us from the evil one. And like I said, he'll come again to make that deliverance complete. So, that's the five petitions of the Lord's Prayer, and I know what you're thinking. There's a piece missing that we prayed earlier, right? There's that piece, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." So, fun fact, the Bible that we have is taken from a bunch of really, really old ancient manuscripts that were dug up hundreds of years ago, and there are some that are older than others. So that phrase, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, yada, yada, yada," that's from actually kind of a newer manuscript. And by newer, I mean still thousands and thousands and thousands of years old, but not quite as many thousands as the first one we have. So sometimes in our Bibles, it's not always added, but it was added as the tradition came on. Now, it's not to say that it's wrong and shouldn't be there and we shouldn't pray it every Sunday like we do. It's to say that this prayer has been prayed for generations upon generations upon generations. And that little kind of doxology, that little moment of praise at the end, has been added by our forefathers and mothers and brothers and sisters And I think that's a beautiful way to end. It kind of bookends this prayer in praise. It began with praise with our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, and now it ends with praise. With thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. It shows us that our prayer lives, our lives of prayer, are rooted in our worship of God. That's why it's so appropriate that right in the middle of our worship service here, we spend some time sharing prayer requests and praying together, praying with each other, and saying this Lord's Prayer, because our prayer is rooted in our worship of God. That's one of the lessons I think Jesus had for us. So that's kind of my piece-by-piece look into what this prayer from Jesus is all about. So then the next question is, what was Jesus' intention with this prayer? What was he trying to teach exactly? And as I mentioned before, he begins with ways that we shouldn't pray. You know, don't showboat. Don't try and put on airs and sound like you're from Kansas when you're from Malaysia and those kinds of things. But here's how you should pray. And here at Harbor Church and at many other churches, we use this prayer just as it stands in Scripture. As we just prayed, you know, 20 or so minutes ago, we took the words right out of Matthew, and we just prayed them right away. And I think soon we're going to sing those words exactly. And I think that's a really good thing to do. I'm not saying that that's wrong. I think it's so beautiful. There's nothing more beautiful than the fact that we can actually pray Scripture. And I think that Jesus had something else in mind, too, when he gave this prayer. He was teaching the disciples and those who were listening to the Sermon on the Mount, and now us. He was teaching us how to pray and giving this prayer as a model. And I don't think that he was giving kind of the ultimate prayer. He wasn't saying, pray these magical words and you've got it right. He was giving us kind of an outline for our own prayers. He was giving us something that I think we can use as a template for our prayers. He was giving us something we can sort of fill in, maybe, with our own lives and experiences. I think that's totally appropriate, to take each petition in turn and kind of fill it in with what's happening in our lives and hearts and mind and situations. I think we can take those five petitions and that doxology at the end that we prayed today, and I think we can use those as an outline to our prayer. So maybe we start with that moment of praise, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. And then I think we can hit pause and insert our own praise. You know, say, God, I saw your holiness when I talked with a friend on this beautiful spot in the water this week. Or, Lord, I saw your holiness when you showed me an answer to this deep question I've been harboring for months earlier this week. We can stop and praise God for whatever he had done in our lives in that moment. And then we can go on and say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and then hit pause again and say, Lord, let your kingdom come into the strained racial relationships in the United States today. Or, Lord, let your kingdom come and your will be done as I seek clarity in my work. Or what's next for my relationship? Or how do I do this with my kids? Or how do I go about this issue in school? We can go and ask God for his kingdom to come and will be done in these specific moments in our lives, and so on and so forth. We can go on through every petition and use it as kind of a theme sparker, a conversation starter with God, if you will. Imagine how rich that prayer would become. It begins and ends with worship. It includes a cry for God's kingdom, and a request for what we need for the day, a moment of confession, kind of our whole life, our whole experience gets wrapped up in this prayer when we do it that way. Jesus covers everything in his prayer, and I think his intention was to help us enrich our prayer lives and make them more meaningful, not just to give us words that we can memorize and say every week, although that's a great thing to do, but also to use it so that our prayers at all times in our own lives and in our churches can be rich and full and transformative as we pray them. So this week, that's my assignment for you. Sometime this week, and I'll do it too, take out your Bible, turn to Matthew, and go through those petitions one by one and use it as an outline. You can do this when you're driving to work in the morning, although maybe be careful with your Bible open then, but you can do it if you're like me and like to journal. That might be a great way to do it. You can do it in the shower while you're getting ready. However you pray best, take some time this week and stop at each petition. Go through this step by step and use it as an outline. Add your own experiences in life and see what happens in your prayer life. See how the Spirit speaks to you maybe a little differently. Sound good? Deal? I'll do that too. All right, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for teaching us to pray. We thank you for caring about us enough that you even teach us how to talk with you best. Help us to use this prayer and to speak with you well. Help us to worship you in our prayer lives and ask for things and even bring our laments and our confessions to you, Lord. And we thank you that you hear them. Use us this week and work in us through your Spirit. And we pray. Amen.
Amen.